Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today, both in person and online. My name is Renee Haltom, Vice President and Regional Executive for the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond's Richmond office. And you have just tuned in online to a Fed Listens event hosted by the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. We're joining you today from on the ground in Lynchburg, Virginia, and we're joined by an incredible panel of business and community leaders from right here in Lynchburg, who are about to share their perspectives on how their economy and community are recovering from the COVID-19 pandemic. I'd like to give a special thank you not only to our panelists today, but to the Lynchburg Regional Business Alliance, who helped us pull this group together and indeed whose offices we're joining you from. And before we dive in with our panelists, I wanted to give you all a little background, a little bit about what the Fed is and the role we play in the economy, why we're doing an event called Fed Listens, and why it's so important to us to learn from our communities. And so first, let's talk about the Fed. If you've read any news articles about the Fed, you can quickly get a sense of a few basic facts. One, the Fed always seems to be doing something with interest rates. Two, we focus on the overall economy, and specifically, we talk an awful lot about jobs and about inflation or keeping prices stable. And three, key people seem to come up often, names like Jerome Powell, Janet Yellen, Ben Bernanke, and Alan Greenspan. So let's break all that down a bit. The Federal Reserve is our nation's central bank. We are not a commercial bank where people watching from home can open an account. Rather, we are known as the banker's bank. The main job of a central bank is to support a healthy economy and financial system. There are 12 regional Federal Reserve banks throughout the country, and the Richmond Fed is one of those. And among other things, we are each responsible for understanding economic conditions on the ground in our districts, which is part of the reason we're here today. We're headed up by a board of governors in Washington, D.C., and our chair is Jerome Powell, one of those famous names I mentioned earlier that often finds its way into the news. And so that's our structure, but what do we actually do? And while we have three key functions, first, we do monetary policy, and I'll come back to that one in a minute. Second, we supervise and regulate banks, which means that along with other agencies, we ensure financial institutions are following safe and sound banking practices. And then third, we provide payment services in the financial system, which means we help move payments from point A to point B, from removing foreign currency and cash from circulation and putting new cash in to running direct deposit systems. But monetary policy, that first objective I mentioned, is what's most relevant to our discussion today. So let me say just another word about that. Monetary policy gets a bad rap for being complicated, and it is. The Fed system has hundreds of economists who can attest to that, but I'm here to share with you that the gist is actually pretty straightforward. Simply put, monetary policy is actions taken by the central bank to influence interest rates in the economy. And specifically, the Fed directly influences interest rates within the banking system, and this indirectly influences a wide array of interest rates through the economy, those paid by businesses, households, and even governments. So why, you might ask, what are we trying to achieve when we move interest rates around? Overall, the Fed's goal is to support a healthy overall economy. When the economy is weak, the Fed typically lowers interest rates to spur economic activity. And when the economy is strong, the Fed might raise interest rates to prevent overheating. So that's the simple version of what we do. We have this relatively blunt instrument of interest rates to give the economy whatever it seems to need at the moment. But you can quickly see how that can get complicated. During the pandemic, for example, some measures of the economy have been strong while others have been weak. Our economy is growing at a quick pace now and prices are rising, but we have millions fewer people working than before COVID hit us. And when you get conflicting signals like this, the Fed has to start making some pretty tough calls. And that is why conversations like we're going to have today are so important. In fact, we spend a lot of time on the ground listening to businesses and community leaders to understand the economy. And that has always been true. But as you might imagine, perspectives from businesses and communities became even more important in the pandemic. This was an unprecedented and rapidly changing event. In the course of 2 months, March and April of last year, we went from the tightest labor market in 50 years to record unemployment. And in that same period, GDP fell by 30% at an annualized rate in a single quarter. And so with a shock of this magnitude, the data and the models couldn't give us a full picture of what was happening in the economy. So talking to people like our panelists today was one of the best information sources we had to understand what was going on and where things were likely to go. And 18 months later, we are still in uncertain times. We have recovered much of the pandemic's economic losses today, but we're not all the way there. Most forecasters expect very hot economic growth this year and next, but we're still down 5.3 million jobs compared to before the pandemic. Millions of workers have left the labor force entirely, and our growth path going forward hinges in part on how many of them are going to come back. We're hearing about price pressures in a lot of segments of the economy, but it's not clear which of these pressures are permanent and which will ease when the pandemic adjustment abates. And one of the hallmarks of COVID was that it hit particular sectors, regions, households very acutely while hardly touching others. And the effects of this disparity will be with us for some time in ways that we need to keep working to understand. And among this are positive stories of ingenuity and perseverance in towns just like Lynchburg. So what bright spots and innovations have come from all we've been through? And so with all that said, we're incredibly grateful for today's panel to help us understand the COVID recovery a bit better from the perspective on the ground here in Lynchburg. As Fed Chair Jerome Powell said last year to the Fed Listens panelists in Washington, D.C., you all add depth and definition to the flood of data that flows through the Fed each day. And so with that, I'd like to turn you over to President Tom Barkin of the Richmond Fed, who will moderate our panel today. And just a brief word about Tom. Tom is president and CEO of the Richmond Fed, and he is responsible for those functions I mentioned, monetary policy, bank supervision, and payment services, and the Fed's national IT organization. He held this position since 2018, and he's also a voting member of the Fed's chief monetary policymaking body, the Federal Open Market Committee, in 2021. And before Tom joined the Fed in 2018, he spent 30 years at McKinsey, and I know he brings that on-the-ground perspective into this role as well. And so with that, thank you all for being here today, and Tom, please take it away.
Thanks, Renee, and thanks to all of you with us today, and thanks for everybody who's listening in. Let's jump into it. I think we want to talk about the labor market. Renee talked about some issues there. And maybe just go around the table. When we do, introduce yourself when I first talk to you. But Michael, why don't we start with you? You know, what are you seeing in the labor market today?
Sure. My name is Michael Elliott. I serve as Senior Vice President of Operations and Chief Transformation Officer at Centra Health. And we are a 7,600 employee company here in Lynchburg. We scan about 9,000 square miles outside of Lynchburg, about the size of the state of New Jersey. And so we have a pretty large footprint. And when we start talking about the labor market, we have been impacted in healthcare from a pandemic standpoint like no other industry that I'm aware of. Not only are people ourselves dealing with the pandemic trying to stay healthy, but we're taking care of those who become ill from the pandemic as well. So there are a couple of factors. I would say, and you've heard this, burnout and also empathy fatigue are real things that our people within healthcare are seeing. On top of that, from a labor perspective, when there is a surge in one part of the country, it doesn't just affect that part of the country. Even before the pandemic, we were in a nursing crisis. And so what happens when there's a surge in one part of the country, where do they get their nurses from? From the rest of the country. And so what they'll do is offer 3 to 4 times the pay. And we have nurses that will leave their hometowns and head to places where they can make 3 to 4 times as much. And that puts pressure on the rest of the community and the country, even when the surge is not that bad in that area. But what we've seen with the surge, it usually moves across the country as well. So lots of things to consider, and that's a perspective from healthcare.
Very helpful. Christine, how about from your constituents here, the Business Alliance?
Sure, thank you, Tom. Well, I'm Christine Kennedy, Chief Operating Officer here at the Lynchburg Regional Business Alliance. We are the regional chamber of commerce and economic development organization. Our footprint is the entire MSA, 4 counties and the city of Lynchburg. We have roughly 750 organizations that are members. Those are everything from small entrepreneurs all the way up to some of the largest manufacturers in our region to nonprofits that serve our public community. And I think for us, what you're seeing initially with the labor market, it was from the manufacturing perspective, safety. Because if you can't keep those workers, which were essential in doing their jobs, it only exacerbates the issue. They got a handle on that really quickly. The work from home community, a lot of those non-essential workers that then went home, there were issues around childcare, education. You were parenting, you were teaching, you were trying to work all at the same time. And I think the long-term impact of that was you are seeing many of those parents that just got out of the labor market altogether. They can't afford emotionally or financially to try to grapple with those two issues. So we're seeing that, and the long-term childcare, daycare shortage that isn't just nationally, we are certainly feeling the effects of that locally. And we're not quite sure how to come back from that. You just cannot find the workers. And as Michael mentioned, the inflated wages is not just happening in one or two industries. It's happening all across. So we're seeing those issues, which are still effects of the pandemic.
Traci.
I'm Traci Blido, and I work with the Central Virginia area for Virginia Career Works. And so we work through the Workforce Innovation Act to bring federal money to help underprivileged people, but also dislocated workers, those that have gotten laid off through some of this pandemic and supply chain issues that has caused that, to help them get reskilled, upskilled. So it's all of that type of work. And we work with, you know, partners. I mean, Sterling's here. He's one of those with the Jubilee Center, but CVCC, our local community college, and, you know, Department of Aging Rehab Services and many others. We work together to help the underserved community to get those skills because we have those issues with workforce. One thing that I think, well, first of all, we have 6,000 job openings in our region. So she talked about 4 to 5 million year over year, more job openings now nationwide, but in our region, it's around 6,000. And that's from 1,500 employers that are posting jobs right now and 477 occupations. So we have to be prepared for all those occupations to make sure that they're filled. And believe it or not, retail that was hit so hard. I mean, they have a lot of job openings right now, but we're at the same time trying to get people to get higher wages so that they have a better living. So there's a lot of things at play. Another thing that's interesting and why we're seeing the shortages that we are is retirements. I was looking at some facts on that, and 44% of those that were eligible to retire pre-pandemic decided to hold off on retirement, and 12% went ahead and retired. You switch that to 2021, and it is completely turned around. 38% today are accelerating their retirement this year, and only 12% are holding back. So that's at play, the childcare issues that Christine talked about, and just the fact that we need to get all types of people upskilled and reskilled and new skills and work through K-12 community college and all the way up.
Well, let's linger a bit on this topic and maybe open it up to anyone in the group, right? Participation is down in the workforce. Unemployment is still elevated. And there's 6,000 job openings right in Lynchburg. What's being done here and what can be done here to try to get people who aren't working into some of these jobs?
Well, my perspective is from the nonprofit side. I'm Bill Bodine. I'm the president and CEO of the Greater Lynchburg Community Foundation. And one of the things we're seeing are nonprofit organizations that are seeking to enhance educational opportunities. There are people that are now running educational facilities to get people who may not be yet fully workforce skilled to get some training and then connecting them with businesses in the area. So there's a pretty decent nonprofit effort to enhance education towards moving people into that workforce.
And is that getting filled with folks? I mean, is that pipeline full, or are you having trouble getting people into
it's,
that pipeline?
It's nowhere near full, but it's a step. And some of these organizations are relatively new, but I've enjoyed seeing them spring up, and I think they're effective, and they're going to be more effective as more people find out about them and participate. But that is happening.
Sterling, you're my name is Sterling Wilder. I'm the executive director for the Jubilee Family Development Center. The Jubilee is an education recreational center with three phases: education, athletics, and occupational. I'm also a member of Lynchburg City Council. So thank you for coming to Lynchburg. We're glad to have you. In my sector, and looking at the city of Lynchburg, and also I work with a lot of maybe person in the kind of poverty industry, a lot of them could not work at home, where they still had to go to work, whether it's like in fast food or the healthcare industry. You couldn't work remotely. So that was a challenge. Going forward, one thing I've seen, this has seen some of the positive pieces where, as Trey said, they're offering certain bonuses for certain positions. So offering certain bonuses, also become more creative in looking for employment as far as new careers and nonprofits like Jubilee. We're doing a STEM center right now, trying to open up for persons, feeding that pipeline to prepare for some of those jobs that are still open in the market, so that prepare person that was like a long-term thing we're working on. But our community college in Lynchburg is so great. They have made strong efforts in training persons in our community to let them know about the G3 program, to let them know about different programs, opportunities for training in our community. So that's one thing that's really interesting right now. Another quick factor I notice is that with COVID, it has taught us to think a lot differently, like working remotely. But also in the times of low hiring of a situation like now, look at persons maybe who have maybe felonies. In the industry, I work with a person who is like deprived and have certain felonies or a challenging job record. Those persons have the hardest time finding employment. So it's taught us differently. Can we give some of them a chance? So take like businesses, picking us, people of faith said, I'm going to give some persons a chance, even though you might have a felony or might have a record or maybe a certain time period, because in the industry, most persons cannot find jobs if you have a bad record. So it's made us think things differently. Mm-hmm. The business leaders can also think differently. Maybe I need to open up my pool more to persons who are looking for employment and can be trustworthy and who are just want a job.
Yeah, that's good. Stephanie, how are small businesses seeing this?
Yeah, I want to add that my name is Stephanie Keener, and I'm the executive director for the Small Business Development Center for the Lynchburg region. We're part of a network of 29 SBDCs across the Commonwealth, a cooperative agreement with the United States Small Business Administration and premier institutions across Virginia. And yes, I have to say that a lot, so I deliver it pretty quickly. I do want to offer a little nugget of information about some of the positive points that Sterling's making. You know, we do a program called Start Smart in our community that's targeted at people who are just thinking about or exploring the idea of entering entrepreneurship or starting a business. And in 2021, we've had more than 200 people register for that program. Now, they don't all show up and they aren't in our region necessarily, so it's a little bit of an inflated number for our region, but that tells me that a lot of folks are really interested in starting a business or at least thinking about it as they may be unemployed or looking for other types of employment. But yeah, our small businesses are struggling finding folks to work. You know, it's a couple of things. I was in a meeting with our early childhood education leaders a few days ago. You're going to hear us bring up early childhood education industry again and again. They are in an absolute crisis. We are hearing that, you know, hours are challenging, pay is challenging in that industry, and vaccine hesitancy is really impacting that industry as well. So it's a challenge for our mom and pop folks, but small businesses across the region.
You were going to say,
Tom. I was just going to say, you asked the question. You know, what is the community doing? And I think from businesses, they're doing a lot more of talking to each other to see how they can remain competitive in their industry.
Absolutely.
If you do not have the top culture in your industry, any potential prospective employee is looking online for your reviews. And if you have one or two bad reviews, we all know you could have 500 great ones. So, you know, we've gone from an employer market to an employee market, and you have got to make sure that you have the best culture with the most competitive wage for your market. And you've got to tell that story well from a branding perspective, because if someone's have a cost of living calculator on your website, if someone is thinking about relocating, make it easy for them to see our quality of life and why they should relocate here with rush minute, not rush hour. So you really have to do your homework as employers. And I think HR departments are burdened now to, you know, do much more than just compliance and policy. You know, then you throw the vaccine challenges on top of that. And also you've got to make our company look like the best thing ever. And oh, where are my workers? And so I think there's also that piece of your culture matters, and how competitive are you really does matter today.
I'm going to add on to that. I think it's exactly right. This is an employee's market, like the way that you coined that. And at the end of the day, I think that's going to be good. It's going to be good for corporate culture. I think it's going to be good for wages, especially those who have been on the front lines, mm-hmm. who like they have been underpaid over time. So hopefully people will get closer to a living wage. And it makes me think of an example that we have at Centra Health, where we've historically had a program if you wanted to become a certified nurse assistant. So we will pay for you to go through your classes. We will give you a stipend while you're in class, and we will guarantee you a job when you are finished. Mm-hmm. And we're gonna need to do more things like that to give people a pathway. And then we also, after you are a certified nursing assistant, there's a pathway for you to become an LPN, an RN, and then continue your education as well.
And my organization helps with that being free.
Yeah, that's right.
One thing I noticed too, like at Jubilee, they've had several open job opening pools. For example, the city of Lynchburg had one at Jubilee because they had so many openings for their positions. So they had a thing there. A church had another event last Saturday for our job openings. And also we just passed it. Also another one, Frito-Lay, they had a job opening fair. So I've seen a lot of career fairs that are going on more than normal. I guess because there's such a shortage of workers that everyone is kind of like now looking for workers and trying to find the best way to find the best workers.
And they're not even mm-hmm. called career fairs anymore. They're called hiring events because yes. they're going to hire you right then.
And yet we still have a bunch of people not in the workforce. Many of them were in the workforce just 18 months ago.
That's right.
And so, you know, I hear a lot of efforts being done in this community to train people, attract people, motivate people, but there's still people. Let's talk a little more about why they're not in the workforce. Do you have a good feel for that? Especially those
barriers.
Who are dealing with them every
it's
day.
It's one word, barriers.
What kind of barriers?
Childcare, transportation. Never been told by your own family that you can do it. I mean, it's just a lot of different barriers. So it's about working with all types of partners that we work together with to help people overcome those barriers.
Mm-hmm. I think barriers is major, especially with childcare. And like right now, one of my kids I was working with rode a bus to school because someone on the bus had COVID. So now the whole bus has to be off like 10 days. So you have parents who have to continue to take off when they can or try to find childcare. But the problem is the child now has to be quarantined. So how can you send them to a childcare facility? So and then some people say it may not even worth it. I talked to one parent the other day in Amherst County. Her child has been school, I think, 7 days since the school started almost 2 months ago because somebody gets COVID in class and they have to quarantine again. And so she said she just wants to homeschool the child. It's not worth it to send them to school. But she has the position that she can do that. But so many persons just cannot, you know, do that because like I said, work in a certain industry, you can't work from home.
Yeah, it's a whole combination of those things. I mean, people are multitasking because they have to worry about helping to educate their child if they can't be in school or just take care of them. And there's transportation issues. And there's also some fear. You know, there's some people that are reluctant to go to places where they might be working inside among other people. And,
right.
and you know, we have to get past all that. And that's a struggle.
How do you, you know, every industry has increased wages, it seems like, over the last 6 months in particular, including a lot of these entry-level jobs, you know, fast food or whatever. Do you guys see that moving people
Absolutely.
Into the workforce, or is it just training people amongst employers?
It's helping retain workers. I know in my own family, I've got a child in the restaurant business and a child in the retail business. It's helped to retain them personally because they've gotten wage increases. Mm-hmm. And we know the data shows that across all industries, it's a 6.5% increase year over year with wages in our region. Now, you know, we are a little bit under what the state is. Northern Virginia seems to pull those numbers up. They're closer to 9% year over year. So we, our goal is to see that continue to increase. And the best thing we can do is help people focus on those trade jobs, professional service type jobs, IT, and move people up.
What do the small businesses say?
Yeah, it's not just increased. I mean, prices are going up because they're paying more wages, but it's not just, I don't think you can blame that just on wage hikes. I think that it's a supply chain issue. Goods cost more. And, you know, if you took economics 101, you know what's happening, right? I mean, they're responding by raising their prices. If you've been to the restaurant, into a restaurant lately, you see that. But, you know, we certainly want to continue to support our local restaurants. And so we pay.
So let's talk about the supply chain stuff for a while, since that's, you know, labor is one part of a supply chain issue. Another part businesses have is materials, goods, commodities. I'd be curious, you know, maybe in healthcare, how are you seeing those, you know, hit your supply chain? You've had, you know, over the last 18 months, a crazy experience, I'm sure.
Right. It's been a roller coaster for sure. You know, most organizations were in a place where we had just-in-time ordering and delivery of supplies before. And that all went out the window, especially when there was the need for PPE and other items to care for folks. And if you didn't have that, you really weren't doing the best to protect your own employees. And so we've gone from a place of just in time to absolute stockpile. And so we have 6, 9, 12 months worth of materials just in case another surge comes and something happens within the supply chain. So it's a completely different world than it was 2 years ago. And we have much more inventory than we used to have.
And you think then the risk is behind you on the supply chain side, or is it going to continue for some time?
We think it's going to continue. I'll tell you why. Not all products are immediately available, and not all products have we been able to stockpile.
Yeah, got it.
And so when we look at the harbor in LA, and there's, you know, 30, 50, 60 ships out there, we know that there are things that our patients and our staff need sitting out there. And so, yeah, we think it's going to take some time for this to clear out.
And Chrissy, we just did a manufacturing roundtable this morning, as you know. I mean, what did you walk away thinking in terms of how long this is going to last?
Well, you know, we have 301 manufacturing firms in the Lynchburg region, and they employ over 14,000 workers and pay high wages. So that part is going really well for our region. We are a diverse economy when it comes to the manufacturing sector. Just about every one of them we've talked to, particularly more in 20, after the initial surge of running out of toilet paper and running out of masks and PPE, the majority of them are looking at shelving product as much as they can. They are preparing for the long haul. This will not end in 2021. This is probably a 2022 and maybe even a 2023 problem, depending on what you manufacture and what you're supplying. And I think then there's the unknown of the long term of global health. This everybody you talk to in the healthcare world is saying, look, we can't say when this is over. It's how are we riding the ship in the new normal? And so we have some really smart leaders within our manufacturing community that are doing what they can do to mitigate those factors. And whether that be stockpiling, whether that be expanding their suppliers. You know, I was so proud of our business community in 2020 and in 2021 of, you know, who else can we do business with? How can we change what we are manufacturing to meet some demand? And we saw that locally. We saw Centra getting provided material that a manufacturer could then produce because they couldn't get that raw material to produce what they were producing. So they started helping where they could. And so I think, you know, this business community, you hear time and time again, and we've heard it over the past 2 days since you've been here, resilient, collaborative. We are, that's the benefit of a small urban city and region, is we are talking to each other. We are looking for solutions where you don't have to go overseas and there's not as much red tape. Local CEOs are making decisions that are impacting our community.
So, Stephanie, you put it pretty well. You've got a higher cost of workers, you got higher costs of materials. That means you got a higher cost of production, which means you have to do something about prices. So I'd love to get a feel from you guys about how are prices changing in this market? And importantly, how does that affect consumers and businesses? Sterling, maybe you want to start.
No, one thing is what you're doing at the nonprofit center, you've seen a lot of issues come up. For example, like in Jubilee, we were mainly run by college students with our volunteers that were running, helped run our school program. Then we had to go to pandemic camp. So we had to have camp all day from 7:30 to 6. But we had the large pool normally. But what happened was when the colleges shut down, we lost all that volunteer help. So we had to hire new staff members. So we had to just, and like I have a letter director that says, I'm not a teacher. But we had to pull the athletic director and have two kids. So it's been some challenges. But as far as that, you have like 40, 50 kids a day. And if you're a licensed facility, you have to serve milk and some other things. But if you go like to Sam's Club, they had a limit of only, you can only get 2 gallons of milk at a time. So we had, and you couldn't get any tissues in the nature during a certain period of time. So we had certain challenges like that in getting materials and meeting our regulatory requirements, and then trying to find ways to get like the milk that we needed going directly to Kroger's and then other places where we could get certain products. So that has been somewhat challenging. And the labor piece for us has been the biggest challenge for a nonprofit, where you can't pay those high wages that you would like to. So you just have to struggle. You can't bring in volunteers because you don't have that pool you normally would have to bring in. So that has been a little struggle for a small nonprofit. And then coming to the prices, notice the price of gas has gone up, price of food has gone up. So that's challenges. They have had like some support to families, like the child care tax credit, get out those support things. And also the EBT, like food stamp situation cards, that has helped some families to need some of that. But again, that's why that runs out. When we have kids home all day, I have 5 foster kids. And they're 5 young teenage males, they eat continuously. I mean, I'm telling you, they eat continuously. So we have a situation like me where kids are there like all day during the challenging time period. You cannot, you just struggle in feeding a family of that size, especially young, strong, healthy young men who would eat everything. And you got to monitor this, so another story. But again, it has been somewhat challenging, probably with the price of food has gone up.
But I was so happy to see that you're now growing a garden and those kids are getting in the dirt and learning how to grow their own food at Jubilee.
And you got to convince kids who don't normally eat vegetables how to eat vegetables. So sometimes, especially in foster care, kids have not, don't eat normal food. They eat like the room of noodle things, mm-hmm. and that's a meal to them. So you got to kind of re-educate them and try to get them to think about the vegetables.
Thank you for teaching them that.
Yes. You've just taken me back to being a teenager. And having that fourth meal a day, I remember that very fondly. So, Bill, what do you say?
Similar things to what Sterling was talking about. I mean, we're on the nonprofit side, so what we see is a need for more volunteers, and the volunteer pool that's gotten a little bit smaller. And Christine brought up a really great point in terms of collaboration. What we've worked to do is try to encourage people to collaborate with each other a lot more on the nonprofit side. We provide about $2 million in grants every year to local nonprofits, and it's not enough. I mean, it's substantial, but it's not enough. And so I think part of our responsibility is to seek ways to encourage people to collaborate, share resources. We have to get better at using the resources we have as efficiently as possible. And that's a big part of what we're trying to do on the nonprofit side.
Others on the impact of prices on consumers, households, businesses here?
I mean, it's tough. People are learning how to grow their own garden, how to canning their own food for the first time. I mean, Bedford County has one of the only canneries around here, and they were packed every single day during the growing season. So, I mean, families are just having to learn things on their own and how to survive.
I want to kind of loop back to that supply chain issue for a second, and I don't mean to be there's a lot of positivity and a lot of cooperation in our region. But I also think there's a lot of nervousness, particularly as we come up on that holiday shopping season. And, you know, Michael mentioned those, and I, by the way, I think it was 73 ships off the coast of California as of yesterday. Maybe you've gotten an update.
You guys seem to have pretty good data.
It's a lot. You know, they're thinking about those toys and gift items that might be sitting out there floating in the Pacific. And even as you shift to thinking about, you know, putting those maybe things that we might think of as hyper locally produced items on the shelves, and I'm thinking about craft beer or, you know, hand poured beeswax candles, those kinds of things. Even those really small businesses are feeling the impact of that, because aluminum, you know, got to put your beer in something. Do you need to resource glass bottles? Or do you need a media to, you know, help you with some of those craft items? It's still pretty nervous for a lot of our folks in our small businesses. So it's kind of my word of the day, I think.
Yeah.
But I do want to emphasize that.
And, you know, this was a major topic of conversation, even on our staff meeting yesterday, is how to help our local community prepare and support local. Because what we know is 80% of our community is made up of small businesses that contribute to the success of our economy. And getting that message out, you know, where are you getting your messages and how are you messaging? You know, we have got to inject more hope into what's happening. And, you know, we start asking questions like, what does this opportunity mean for you? Instead of, oh my gosh, we can't get something from the port. Okay, well then what's the opportunity in that? You can now make sure that your neighbor who creates candles, you know, survives the holiday season. And so I think it's intentionality in injecting hope into this market. And yes, there are long-term ramifications, and we've seen our world disrupted, but we also have to disrupt the thinking that is doom and gloom and be more opportunistic in what we're doing. And I think that's why this community is so resilient, and we are working on collaboration, and we aren't duplicating resources. Bill made a great point. You know, nonprofits, they've gotten together, and the funding of the nonprofits have said, look, if you're doing the same service, if y'all aren't working together, we're not going to fund you.
That's right.
And we want to know what the impact is. And so not only businesses, but the community at large, you know, we need to be asking more innovative questions, more problem solving questions, just not, you know, what's the impact of this? It's what are we going to do about it? What are we going to do about it? And how are we going to rise above this and innovate and make our community better? And I think that's what's been so encouraging to see, is we're not going to settle for what's happening. We're going to look at what we can do as a result of it.
You know, I don't know if you've seen the nonprofit for us. We have seen more donations come in during this pandemic. I think because we are such a resilient community, where they say, what can I do to help in this time of need? So those who do have some wealth, they have poured more funds into Jubilee, the bunch of the nonprofits I work with, during this challenging time period, which has been kind of one of the better years we've had. And I think because people have seen how people have struggled so much and the challenges that everybody's having feeding kids. And one of the donors gave us a fund the other day, and she said, I did this because you stayed open during the pandemic. You kept a place for the kids to come to learn, but they couldn't have internet at the house or in their apartments, or they lived in a house with multi-generational persons and you had no tutoring space. If you live in a nice home, your own private room, your own internet, it's different. But if you live in like an apartment with one bathroom or two bedrooms, you share a room, and you have a person of generational grandmothers or grandmothers in the same place, it's challenging for a child to study. So the person that donated to us, maybe because we had space for kids to come and learn, whether it's in our classrooms, in our gym, or even I would come in one day, big kids in a hallway on a Zoom. So we had additional space for that. We were blessed with that. So I think persons have donated and seen that. So I've seen persons, because we are so resilient, we do give a lot in our community. When we see a need, we do step up. So I'm thankful that our community has stepped up, like the Foster family. They have stepped up to meet some of the needs in our community.
Yeah, we're seeing the same thing, Sterling. We had, we're a 50-year-old foundation, and we had the best year we've ever had in terms of of new donations coming in last year, which I was surprised at. I expected people to kind of hunker down and be more protective of what they had, but people really stepped up and realized the needs were there. And that's, you know, I'm really proud of this community for that.
You know, maybe Christine, Bill, what are four or five of the things that this resilient community has done over this last 18 months that'd be, you know, worth lingering on?
I would say partnerships. Like my organization is partnering to help pay for the salary of someone at Parkview Mission so that it helps our numbers, because we want to train people, we want to get them skilled. And Parkview Mission was doing some life skills training for people and things. And so to partner with them and help both of our organizations succeed in helping these people, those types of things. And that's just one example. I'm sure that you're seeing partnerships like that.
I would say it's the power of yes. And I know that sounds so simple, but you know, when the crisis hit, we reached out to key stakeholders that had answers, Virginia Department of Health, Centra, you know, the state, on some of the legalities of some of the shutdown, and them saying yes to doing a Zoom, them saying yes to continuing to talk with us on a weekly basis. When I say us, whoever we needed to convene, when we would get a call from manufacturers that, hey, I'm having this issue, can we talk about it? Yes, we can talk about it. Our educational community, all of our five regional high school systems, all of our colleges, since the pandemic began, have talked either weekly or biweekly with Centra and Virginia Department of Health and the business community. Now, that does not happen, you know, without the power of yes. And I think that is building resiliency, because they're sharing their stories. They're sharing what's working, what their frustrations are, and looking to how can we problem solve together for something the whole community is facing. And so I think it's, you know, finding that yes, how can we come to the table to find those solutions and to be a solution? And we've just seen time and time again, no matter who you call, literally, no matter who you call. And I can't do it on that day, but can we talk tomorrow? So I think it's the power of yes, and that builds resiliency. And we're gonna rise above this, and this community globally, we will rise above this. And societies throughout history have rebuilt from tragedies, but they've innovated, and they have grieved what no longer can be, and risen to the new. And we'll do the same.
A couple of real quick examples. Our foundation has spearheaded the formation of a new website called Share Greater Lynchburg. Mm-hmm. There are 120 different local nonprofits listed there. And so it's a central place for people who need resources to be able to research that by category.
Right.
And then there's also opportunities for volunteers listed on there. There's an Amazon wish list for these organizations if people want to donate goods or money. So we've tried to bring that together for better information in one place, and that helps encourage collaboration, we think. And the other thing is, one of the things we're really blessed with in our region is we have several colleges and universities, and they bring tremendous resources in terms of their knowledge and their people power. And so we're working right now with the University of Lynchburg to get better data on outcomes, for example. Yeah. We typically have provided grants, but we haven't always done a great job evaluating what those outcomes of the grants are. We know what people have done with the money, but you know, are we really moving the needle on some of these issues? And so the university is helping us evaluate data right now on food provision. Are people eating healthier? Are they getting better access to food and healthy food? So we have those resources here, and we have used them, but there's more available for us to utilize to improve the whole region.
Good. Okay, so let's turn for a second. I guess we're already headed that way toward disparities, right? And so I'd just be curious to go around and say, you know, where do you see this economic recovery as still uneven? Obviously, we talked a lot about disparities at the beginning, but given where we are today, where are you still seeing it as uneven, and what risk does that create?
You know, one thing we talked about disparities earlier, you know, the challenge is, especially person in the minority community, also in the low income community, they've always had challenges. Mm-hmm. So now it's been exacerbated, even stronger, because you just continue to have those challenges. There might be some opportunities to get employment now, which weren't there. So at least that's somewhat opening up. But again, there's still that fear factor. You know, you still got to prepare. One thing we talked about in the workforce board one time, but that even though you have training programs, getting persons to those programs, preparing them for those programs, make sure they have the essential skills to be successful in employment. They had a Frito-Lay event, like I said, last Saturday, persons came not dressed properly. And they said, don't wear jeans. They had to turn people away. So we still got to educate people. So that's going to be a challenge.
They turn people away who were wearing jeans?
Yeah, but they had a strict dress code and how you're supposed to present yourself. So they had it on the forum, so they ended up turning some people away.
So if the person couldn't follow the directions right. they read, then how could they work there?
Got it. Kind of thing. Interesting.
So you have to look, just
it seems like if you're desperate for workers.
Right.
Yeah. So it's a lot of education that you still have to do. So you're already in a challenging environment. You're already in a challenge with the income. So it just continues to grow. So you're already all behind. And then you're not going to talk about the education behind. You know, the education divide, there's challenges in our learning, our population of students, especially persons of color, and certain testing scores. And you've been out of school for like 6-7 months, you know, and like now, like when my kid of mine is out for 10 days. So he's already made so much challenges. So now that divide is going to be even larger. Now, if you have a person that makes him stay home or work from home and work with Johnny on assignments, but you have a mother who might be in the healthcare or a mother who's working at a fast food, can't work with Johnny, Johnny's going to be home alone. Just doing fitting for herself, eating noodles and noodles and not eating the healthy meal, but not being able to study properly. And it would happen if you have a poor internet connection. You know, now if you don't have internet during this time of pandemic, you're gonna be in serious trouble. Mm-hmm. Now, the school system has done various hot spots and things like that, but still that's challenging. You know, even though in my house, I have a large old house, it's still challenging. In my house, I put boosters and things, but I just can imagine I can buy boosters of that nature. What happens if you can't do that? Or if you live in an apartment, you can't get your internet. So that's going to be worse for our kids. We haven't even seen the effects of kids, the socialization of them, and also the challenge they've already had academically, how it's going to affect them long term. So it just continues to strengthen and encourage that same problem you already had. It just makes them larger.
That's right. And one thing that we're doing, I mean, my organization is regional, and just this is 2,000 square miles, Lynchburg region. So mm-hmm. it's four counties surrounding the city. So we make it a point to make sure that we get out to all the areas because there's this whole rural divide versus the mm-hmm. city as well and what services are provided. So one of the things that we've done in Bedford County and Campbell County, we've got career navigators that work with youth that can identify those that are falling through the cracks, not going to the four-year college, and not even knowing how to fill out the FAFSA forms at CVCC to get in, and helping them know what the opportunities are and how to apply for community college and things like that. Putting people out there.
And they're finding people are receptive to and
it's helping tremendously. Yeah. Their numbers, I mean, once we placed, we're Bedford County and Campbell County are helping pay for that person to be out there. And then we're using those federal funds to fill that gap. And once we did that, we saw the numbers going up, getting them hooked up with community mm-hmm. college, getting in those trades and things like that.
Yeah, we talk about people falling through the cracks.
Yeah.
So if you were teetering financially prior to the pandemic, there's more cracks for you to fall into.
Right.
If you were teetering from finding food security, there's more cracks. Mm-hmm. If you were teetering to find childcare, transportation, mental health, mm-hmm. if you were teetering with your mental health, there were more cracks for you to mm-hmm. fall into. I love this community because we've come together to try to fill as many of those cracks as possible, but it's absolutely, if you were already teetering, there were more places for you to fall down than before. So we're trying to rally together to make sure we give everyone a hand up. But absolutely, if you were in a place of vulnerability, it has been a challenge. And I'm proud of this community for coming together to try to pull people up.
Talk a little about health disparities too.
Yeah.
Not just mental health, but physical health disparities.
Absolutely. And so because of some of our toward history in this country as well. We saw people of color For example, not getting vaccinated. We saw people of color putting off care, and that's coming home to roost right now. So people who put off care during the beginning of the pandemic are coming to our facilities now sicker than they've ever been.
Oh, you're seeing that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So putting off primary care, people trying to stay away from public institutions, stay away from people. So, you know, we've got a lot to unravel over the next several years to try to get people back to where they were previously from a health perspective, and hopefully to a better place.
You know, I think that's really true from a business perspective as well. I mean, we heard a lot of news about how our small businesses that were led by people of color didn't receive PPP or EIDL or some of the other loans and other programs at the same rate as white-owned businesses did. I can tell you anecdotally, in this community, we continue to have folks come into our office who say, I didn't know about these programs. And those are primarily people of color. And it is heartbreaking to look at a small business owner, somebody who has put their life savings, worked so hard into their landscaping, catering, often, you know, service businesses, and to say, I'm sorry, but there's nothing left. You can apply for a loan, the economic injury disaster loan, or another regular loan. But again, they may be underbanked. They may be have not the best record keeping. Some of the things that those programs demanded in order to be able to access them, they aren't able to access. And the situation has really highlighted the need for the SBDC to do better education for some of those financial issues that some of those small businesses may have. And we certainly want to take up that charge, but we also want to make sure that we're talking to our bankers about the need for more access to capital, perhaps for some of those riskier and smaller loans that they may not have wanted to do before. And also to talk to investors about investing in small businesses that may not normally seek investment. Things like caterers and landscapers, right? You don't have to invest in tech companies all the time. I mean, we've got some folks out here who are working hard and deserve that attention from our investment community.
You know, just 2 points. Well, one point about the PPP loans, one thing for the city of Lynchburg with Marjette Epshire, we tried to make sure that our minority community knew about those loans. So I, on the city council, she brought it to us. One thing I was stressing in my role as city council, I'm trying to board two, which is one of the majority African-American communities. I tried to make sure that when they presented information that the minority community businesses, they were aware of that. So they're part of like the NAACP and rest other organizations. So they could be aware of those opportunities. So that's one thing, at least we did make some efforts to make sure people of color, especially, were aware of those opportunities. And getting to the healthcare issue, we just have, unfortunately, persons of color have more severe healthcare issues. Whether it's eating, whether it's whatever the case might be, they have more healthcare issues. And then you have some hesitancy taking the vaccine. You have this certain study like the Tuskegee study, where again, that even though that was about 50 years ago, I guess, those kind of studies are still kind of in your mind, right? But they just didn't give persons the treatment for the disease. So those things out there. So trying to change the community about healthcare, you're afraid to get the vaccine and trying to educate them about that. And then you already have some health issues and you're putting off those, getting that proper healthcare you really needed. And then for a period, certain offices were closed. So if you didn't want to get healthcare, you couldn't even get healthcare because the offices were closed and they'd have certain challenges of getting persons in. So I think that's some issues. But again, getting back to our resiliency piece, you've seen like about a month ago, we had a seminar at Jubilee sponsored by a group for Gen Z, I guess it is, for those 24 to 14 to 30 age year old bracket, whatever, I'm totally fast. But again, they had a seminar mainly just for that group. They had 6 African-American doctors to meet with persons in our community and talk about COVID, talk about the vaccine, had the free COVID test, had the free vaccine out there for persons, trying to reach them. But for me, this resiliency, for me and being Lynchburg, and I'm from here, to see six African-American medical doctors to come to or do a presentation. Now, if you're in Richmond or Norfolk or New York, this is something you can just probably see normally. But for me, to see that in Lynchburg, to see six African-American physicians to come and talk to the person in the city community, this is why you should get the vaccine. This is the information, get rid of all those misconceptions. It just shows the resiliency that I've never seen in my life to get six doctors of any color to come to Jubilee for a panel on a Saturday. That to me was historical.
That's right. So let's turn and talk about Lynchburg, right? You know, we all say, you know, this pandemic, we're changed forever, et cetera, but, you know, talk about Lynchburg. How has Lynchburg changed because of this pandemic? What's been positive? What's been negative?
Gosh, that's difficult because you see every day certain things that are positive. We're closer to our families and you know, we have more of a, there's a tenderness, so to speak, with even my own children and knowing what they're going through in this. It's difficult to navigate all of this with COVID, and they're out there in the front lines. And so I think families are getting closer. But at the same time, there's curveball after curveball. And so we do have to be completely resilient throughout this whole ordeal. And when will it end is the other thing. So, you know, you call it the new normal. And I think, I don't even know if that fits anymore because it's just kind of, we've just learned to live in a whole different way and to work in a whole different way.
You know, I think our region fares well because we do have a diverse economy. We have multiple sectors that are doing well. So if one gets hit, there's enough to right the ship. So I think that's going well. We have a strong educational base here, both K-12 and post-secondary. We're rallying around non-traditional education to get credentials and certifications. The state is injecting resources locally to make sure that happens. So I think the education system is strong. We do have, as Bill mentioned, the Share Greater Lynchburg collaborative with all the nonprofits. So that's, it's a funnel, a gatekeeping organization. So if you want to get involved. So I think those things are going well. I think as Michael mentioned, you know, the ones that are falling through the cracks or that could fall through the cracks, that is always something that's heartbreaking, and that this community, you know, we can't be desensitized to that. We can't look at people as a statistic. And sometimes we just want to know where the number's going down. And that's all well and good until you know the 80-year-old that whose elevator in Section 8 housing is broken, that can't get her medicine and can't get out of her apartment. And very real situation right here in Lynchburg right now that just got fixed. I mean, people locked in their apartment for over a week because their elevator's broken, right? So we can't dehumanize the numbers. And so I think our community is doing really well to stay on top of that and to talk about that. We just finished our community health needs assessment process for this round. And so looking at what's behind the numbers and getting some of those stories, you know, as Centra's leading that charge. And then, you know, what can we do about it? So it's solutions-based thinking. In the midst of being resilient, we still have some that really need some help, and we're making headway, but how do we collaboratively work on that? To have more positive impact. So we don't keep seeing the same challenges over and over again. I mean, we're a smart country. We're a smart community. Why are we seeing these same things habitually? And we got to get to the bottom of that.
Well, I think the other thing, you know, COVID related is, quite honestly, this is a politically conservative area. And we've allowed, to some degree, the vaccination issue to be politicized to the point where we have very low vaccination rates here still compared to most areas of the state and the country, in fact. And, you know, without turning this into a political discussion, I think it would be really nice if we could work harder towards making sure that that misrepresentation of factual information gets limited, and that we, you know, we get people to pay more attention to the science and the reality of the situation rather than allowing it to become decision.
You know, Bill brings up a good point. We just launched a survey a few weeks ago to our employers, asking them about their employee reactions to vaccines. And the top three issues, the number one was more time to study. We want to know what the long-term ramifications are of a vaccine. The second most frequent answer was, I have pre-existing conditions and I'm scared of what that will do. We just don't know. And number three was, I do not trust anybody in the government. And those are things we needed to know, that having the data. And so now working with our health officials, our local, if you won't trust anybody nationally, to your point, having the local doctors come in and talk about it, humanizing and putting a local face on some of the data, we hope helps that, because, you know, without knowing that, we don't know how to mitigate that. And so just having that data and turning that data over to our health department and our local hospital system, we hope helps so that they can work on those issues.
Well, I agree. I mean, I think the government is not the agency that's best suited to convince people what they should do scientifically. And I think that we may get more trust if people listen to this, the scientific community rather than the political community.
And I'm not trying to be political either, but I had a relative who talked about the vaccines in nature. I'm just understand we've been taking vaccines for years for polio and other things. I'm just trying to understand still why is this so controversial? That's what I'm still trying to understand and wrap my mind around. And the other quick thing, when I looked at the situation look at the other question you had with positive and negatives. Some of the positive pieces are, it's taught us how to work differently. It's taught us how to work yeah. remotely. It's taught us to be resilient. Different training opportunities for partnerships. But some of those negative effects, the achievement gap is getting larger.
Right.
Mental stress is getting more larger as well. And also our schools, I worry about our schools that continue going forward. You got a classroom closed this week, a whole kindergarten class closed this week for 10 days. You got kids on the bus closed for 10 days. I'm just afraid of the long-term effects of what's going to happen. And you had kids who were out of school for like almost 18 months, pretty much, working remotely. You know, that's just challenging. Who've missed the socialization, who's missed senior proms. One thing, I still remember my senior prom 100 years ago. So it's just so sad. Persons did not have that effect last year. They'll never have those memories of that. You know, you can't share with your kids, I remember prom. I didn't have them because of the pandemic. You know, so those kind of things, the positive and the negative.
We're not going to cover your senior prom. I just want to close on the vaccine thing. You know, Lynchburg has been a place with very elevated cases over the last, you know, month or two. You've all talked about efforts that are being made. Are those efforts making progress? I mean, is this, you know, you can try hard, but is it moving the needle, do you think, in terms of the health of this community?
I would say very slowly.
Very slowly.
Very slowly. I think the most effective conversations are between an individual and someone they trust, mm-hmm. and hopefully someone they trust that's within the medical field. Or they've had a close friend or family member with, unfortunately, a bad experience from COVID. And hopefully a good experience from getting the vaccine. And so I will tell you, I love the fact that there's been so much collaboration within our community. We were collaborative before. We're ultra collaborative now, no doubt about it. But it, no, mince no words about it. We're divided as well around this. I would call it a politicized issue as well. So at the end of the day, I think over time, we're going to see more vaccinations as people become more trusting. Part of it's going to be vaccine requirements. I see no angle at which vaccine requirements actually slow down or go away. They're going to increase over time. And so the vaccines that are out have been studied. Literally half of humanity has received a dose. And if you look at the actual mechanics of the vaccine, really long-term effects, while we don't have that much experience, we don't have 10 years of experience with it. Based on what's in these vaccines, we can tell you long-term negative effects are very unlikely.
Good.
But the long-term effects from having COVID are very likely, and we're seeing it in about a third of individuals who get COVID.
Now, I was a part of a group yesterday, email chain, and we were doing a joint statement about the vaccine, about encouraging the person to get the vaccine, and some other joint statements that we were doing together. And of course, one person in the group wanted to be negative and make it more political. What I responded with was a picture of a young man, 27 years old, with the Liberty University Southern Praise Team, died from COVID last week. He's someone recording we did at our church last year. He got COVID while he was in Florida, working at an internship at a church. And this gentleman, he, and I understand also now, today, he didn't have the vaccine. 27 years old. So I sent that group a picture of him, let them make it more reality. Look, this is what COVID looks like. This young man, 27 years old, still trying to find his career in an internship, is now gone because he didn't get the vaccine. You know, so I try to put a face with it so they can say, this is real. You know, try to get rid of that political piece. Say, this is life or death.
Last comment that I'll make there is that I think we have an opportunity with speaking with pastors that can really help influence their congregation or the mothers of people that they can, that the mothers then can influence in their household. So, you know, we have to look at where we can help too. And if we can connect with some of them, I think that might help.
Maybe on a happier topic, come back to Lynchburg. There is this a story that's out there that people are leaving the big cities and coming to the small towns. Mm-hmm. Lynchburg's probably a mid-sized town, not a small town, but just be curious, are you seeing in-migration or out-migration during all this? If you're seeing in-migration, what's that doing to housing, the city, workforce, employers, vibrancy? Yeah, just be curious how that whole story is playing out in Lynchburg.
You know, there were headlines 2018 and 2019 about the death of the small town. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally. And now we're seeing headlines of people are leaving large cities that are, you know, millions of people because of a pandemic and choosing to live somewhere where it feels safer. And so we have benefited from that. We've benefited from folks that are now working from home. They can choose to live wherever they want to live, and they're choosing a community within our region. Low cost of living, huge quality of life, beautiful mountain views, you know, all of those things, affordable housing, and still working for a larger company and maybe another part of the state or even out of state. So you're seeing that. You're seeing the work from home kind of professional community that's coming here. But you're also seeing people that are really questioning what they want their life to be about, right? Because life is short, and COVID has taught us that some things matter and some things don't. And in a region like Lynchburg, we have a lot of reasons to want to live and work here and play here. And whether that's the recreational opportunities to the diverse work culture that we have here, to the family orientation. We are a very family oriented community, top schools, you know, all of that. So we are certainly capitalizing on those that are choosing to leave the larger cities to a mid-sized urban region like we have here.
Yeah, we definitely have a really hot real estate market right now. You see homes turn over very quickly. And I can tell you that I work with a rental property manager who has about 45 homes, not apartments, houses on her books. She doesn't have a single one in inventory right now.
That's right. We have population growth in all of our areas in our region. We have, I know at Smith Mountain Lake in our community, that's in our region. The Airbnbs are just like, you know, they're all, you can't go on vacation there for 2 years. I mean, they're booked. And so we know that we're getting a lot of vacationers here. Mm-hmm. And then we're not seeing anybody kind of moving away from here. Instead, we're seeing the opposite.
And I guess then, are we seeing that as good because you have more workers, more taxpayers, or is it bad because it's having to do with housing prices, people services, if you have retirees, and are always going to invest in the schools. You know, all those, I'm just curious how that.
Well, infrastructure certainly is going to be a topic of conversation in the next couple of years, both physical infrastructure and just, you know, overall infrastructure of how we do life. I mean, more people, it impacts things. And so I think there you're going to see some of that right now. It's been nothing but positive, but it does wear on facilities and infrastructure and roads and all of those things. And so, you know, relying on and having conversations with our transportation officials and our boards of supervisors and our city council for some long-term planning around that.
And obviously in this crisis, we've talked about it. Broadband is the one piece of infrastructure people talk about the most. You know, you've got a city here, you've got four big, and I'd say pretty hilly, mountainous, you know, surrounding counties.
Challenge.
Where do you sit on that? And is that a place where you go, no, this is doable, or you still have real challenges there?
It depends on the locality. I came from Bedford County previous to this job that I just started July 1st, and they're putting all of their eggs in that basket. They are really funding broadband finally after many, many years and challenges geographically. But they are having to do that with different technologies, different providers, piecemeal, because it's such a big county. And there's a lot of challenges there. And local governments aren't running the broadband, but they have to write the grants and manage those grants and then work with private people. And some of them are, you know, there's some smaller firms that are kind of hard to work with. And then you've got your bigger ones that, but they have their jurisdictions only. And then you have to work with those smaller firms. So there's a lot of pieces to it.
I think that's a perfect example of every crisis has an opportunity. And I think it certainly fast tracked some of the broadband enhancements in our region and the need. It's no longer, oh, we'll get to that. We don't have a choice because the schools need it. And our folks that are working from home, the corporate community is saying, if my people are going to work from home, we got to have internet for them. That's so right. I think it's almost, that's the one thing, the bright spot that I think COVID has done is say, look, we can no longer say it's okay to have spotty areas in our locality. And they're figuring it out. There are definitely some challenges with figuring that out and what those public-private partnerships look like.
And that's, and there's no politics anymore with broadband. Everybody agrees on this.
Yeah.
And just a little subject, go back to another point you were making. As far as, you know, able to work home remotely and things of that nature, I wonder what are the long-term effects of that. I've talked to one person, they said they're just tired of working at home, that they don't go anywhere. They're just in the house all day from 9 to 6, just in a Zoom meeting or a meeting. I wonder what's the long-term effects of that going to be when you just don't get to go trust up with coworkers or go have lunch in the office or something like that, or have a potluck meal at the office. This don't have anymore. So you can be working at home all day long. It's one of the long-term effects of that on persons.
Well, I think what you're going to end up with is a mixture. You're like, from my standpoint, there will be times where I will want to have a Zoom meeting because we've got people that are coming from the other side of Bedford and it's convenient to do that. So we've learned how to use technology, but I really don't see us ever getting completely away in a large scale way of people having offices or going to an office or working together. I think we're going to blend some of that stuff as needed, but I don't see us becoming a society that where nearly everybody works from home.
No, but instead what we're seeing are companies that want to be that employer of choice. And so they have sort of a work appropriate mentality. If you need to be in the office, you be in the office. If you need to meet with a small team, you do that. If you can work from home, you do that. Just be productive. And as long as we see that, we're okay.
And if you're somebody that doesn't want to be at home for long periods of time, or that affects your mental health or whatever it is, you have the option
to be in the office.
To being in the office. That's what I really
but
see.
But then when you go to the office, you're like,
There's nobody here. But what happens if it's like a company that's out of state and you said come here and work here, so if I can still work here, then you can't go into the office. But again, it's a long-term situation.
Well,
you have to make a decision.
And you know, when we took a risk when we purchased this facility, And one of the things we're now seeing is we have office space that we're providing our corporate community for situations just like you're talking about.
Yeah.
So that, look, if your company is still on lockdown, but you need people,
yeah.
you know, come where there's a little bit more energy. And we're seeing our uptick in our member office spaces getting used for that very reason.
Yeah,
and that's an excellent idea for meeting the need of the community.
And you know, Lynchburg's invested heavily over the last 25 years in its center city, that's downtown. Just spend a second on what's happened to real estate in Lynchburg, given, you know, people working from home. Is that, you know, that, or maybe there are more people living here and so people are shopping and being there, or maybe they're not. Is it, has it affected the health of the center city?
It's doing great. That's where we've seen a lot of population growth, and that's where, you know, homes are selling, and we're seeing growth in this region.
Good.
We have a success story here.
Yeah, okay.
Lots of conversions of old warehouses to loft apartments and condos and,
so
and new buildings. I see it as a positive, but I think Christine hit it on the head when she said it's all about planning. You know, growth is good as long as you're ready for it and you anticipate it and provide the infrastructure that's needed. We have to plan ahead.
And our localities are doing that. And that's what, you know, you've got to be forward thinking these days. You can't wait. Companies aren't waiting 24 months to make decisions on where to relocate. They need you to be ready. And so, our communities, our regional economic development team meets on a monthly basis to talk about those things. What are the deficits that we need to overcome quickly so that we're ready for any company that wants to make an expansion announcement or any company that wants to relocate here or bring part of their team here?
We haven't talked about the universities. Yeah, this is a university town in a lot of ways. I'd just be curious how you see them evolving during this crisis and what's, you know, where are they headed, and particularly, you know, in their mission to, if you will, produce a talented workforce.
Well, I'll start with our community college. They just started the CTE Academy because they see that there's such a skills gap. So they're trying to get people locate, you know, right into those shortage areas with the trades and offering everything from welding and HVAC and healthcare as well is part of that. And then K-12 schools, I think, need to shift a little bit too. What we're seeing as far as what the needs are, businesses are saying that they need to hire people that know how to use MS Office across the board with PowerPoint, Word, Excel, and our schools need to look at what those needs that businesses are saying, then teach that from, you know, in the K-12 area before they go to community college. So there's a lot of different shifts that need to take place, I think.
On the collegiate level, we're part of a, talk about collaboration, we're part of a grant process with both Blacksburg and Roanoke. All of our colleges are convening around what do the companies need? How do we get interns into those work-based learning internships into those companies? What are the barriers to the schools being able to get into those industries? What are the shifts that need to take place? So, that it's a three-year grant process that just started. But that's been fascinating to see. What do we need to ask? You know, what data do we need to be able to make those informed decisions so that we can ensure that our schools are relevant and providing the educational knowledge to go in? And then how do we complement that with work-based learning that's relevant to the jobs of today? And even our we're very strong liberal arts community here, even those schools, you know, Sweetbriar, that is a great comeback story, that's still an all-female school with a specialty in female engineering right now. I mean, that's huge, right? To all of our liberal arts schools that are realizing we can add credentials into our four-year degrees. So,
right.
You can't beat the liberal arts education and what it provides you to be prepared for real world living, but then making sure that they're going to leave there not with just a degree and certainly skills that will make sure that you're in demand once you leave that school. So we certainly see that in our community.
That's right. I mean, I have real concerns for the small liberal arts institutions, and that was I came through one of those, and that was a great experience for me. And I worry that we're going to lose that aspect of our education. But we are seeing places like the University of Lynchburg, for example, with their healthcare related. I mean, they're practically living off of their healthcare training programs that they've developed over the years in Centra and others. But I certainly would hate to lose the any of the small liberal arts schools that we have, because they enrich the community.
And all of our colleges, Randolph, Liberty University, right. Lynchburg, you know, I mean, all of them are working with our companies in this community.
Yeah, they are.
And so I can't speak enough about that to make sure that any student that wants a real world experience in one of our organizations, they have an opportunity to do that.
That's right. We see schools like Liberty University, this massive university that is stepping up their School of Engineering and trying to raise up the scale and be closer to what a Virginia Tech has in the future. So they're getting there slowly. So I think the universities are responding, but we need them to do it faster.
Right. Okay. I know we're trying, this is great. Maybe I'll go around for everybody and just for the community that you're most familiar with, just talk about the level of confidence right now in, you know, the next 12 to 24 months. And what have we not covered that we need to focus on? But, you know, what can you tell us about how your community's feeling? And maybe Stephanie, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I think, you know, I said it once before, I'll say it again. I think nervousness around a lot of issues that are happening, a lot of parts of the wheels that are moving, right? I mean, we have the employment issue, we have the supply chain issue. I think that our small businesses are paying attention to those issues possibly for the first time in their business lives, right? So I don't want to seem, you know, negative about it, but I do think there's a good amount of nervousness, and we need to pay attention to that in order to serve our small businesses the best way that we possibly can.
You know, I'll continue on the same thing that the community I primarily work with. Again, you still have certain challenges with supplying for your food for your family, making sure that Latinos' prices go up and the price of gas went up, and how to transport your kids from here to there. That's a challenge. I had one kid call me the other day. His mother took him to a doctor's appointment, but didn't have gas to take him to school. So I had to go and take him to school. So those are real life challenges, even just the gas. Yeah, real life challenges. Another thing is, well, you don't have the ability to work from home. What happens if your child's out again from school? So you get this continuous pandemic going forward. Should I stop working? Or how do I do this? Because I got a child at home who's in elementary school. I can't leave them by themselves. So how am I going to go forward, not knowing it's going to be out again next week because he rode on the bus? Now he can't go to school for 10 days. What's the ramification of that? How long is it going to continue on? So just that uncertainty of life, and it's the cost of things in life. And then just a continuous wage, just trying to get the right training program. You know, then how am I going to do this with child care? So do I have that leap of faith to leave this job or whatever and try to get that better training opportunity? So it's a lot of still kind of uncertainty going forward of what's going to look like.
I want you to underline the word child care. That's an issue.
Say more about that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's child care, not having appropriate child care is a barrier to not just employment and education, but it's a barrier to entrepreneurship as well. You cannot start a business, even if you want to, if you do not have an appropriate place for your kids. On the other hand, you know, we talk to people frequently about maybe starting a business in early childhood education. We can help support them through that process. But, you know, there are so many cogs in that wheel that it's a really difficult lift to get those businesses off the ground. And I just go back to that banking issue sometimes. Early childhood education is an industry that is led by women and people of color. And those are folks who have traditionally had lower wages. So when they come in and ask for a loan, they may not have the equity in their homes or other things to be able to really make that loan happen. So it's a challenge.
We talk about childcare, but also affordable childcare.
Yeah.
You might find childcare, but can you afford it? That's another challenge. And with the problem with the school system being so many challenges right now, it's because they closed, you got to find the childcare piece. And they can like get them. What if I don't have a car? I gotta ride a bus. How am I gonna get to child care? So I guess the person in the low economic bracket, you got so many barriers. Transportation to childcare to employment, you've got these continuous barriers.
Right? We don't even have enough bus drivers in the community right now.
You know, there's buses at the school. We, the first week in our school system, they were like fixed short of like 60 bus drivers, which is unbelievable. You know, you couldn't do the bus routes properly because you didn't have enough bus drivers. You know, so it's just a continuous challenge.
But our churches are stepping up more than they ever have. And I've seen even a church just recently opened their own private child, not private, because their subsidies have the subsidy program too. But that was because they kept hearing people in their congregation saying that there was that need. So they have a daycare in their church, and we need more churches to do that. And the churches that do have those childcare programs, I would love it if they would look into the state subsidy program and see if they can. I know sometimes they don't want to do that, but things have changed, and now it's opened up to so many more families. I mean, you can pretty much make almost $100,000 a year and still get the subsidy. I mean, I'm exaggerating, but it's changed. A lot has changed. So you can get the affordable childcare program at higher wages than you used to be able to.
Confidence in the community.
I think there's a lot of confidence in the community, but I think what our responsibility is to, one of the big issues we have is we have a higher level of poverty than we should have, certainly. And I think we need to engender hope in people that the cycle of poverty can be broken. And until there's hope that can change, there's little incentive for people, whether it's people trying to help or people that need help, to do the things that are required to break that cycle. And I think we talked about hope earlier in this discussion, and I think that's a key piece of it. But yes, we have enough of a history here, and we have enough resources and willpower to change things that I have confidence, and I think there's a level of confidence in this community that's warranted.
Yes.
Tracy.
I have family that's from outside of Virginia. When they come here, they say things are really happening here. We have a good, like I said, there's a success story. You live in Richmond, you probably see a whole different thing and a whole different feel than when you're here. People are more open. People are more, working together, and they're out and about. So I do think hope is the key word here.
Michael?
Just to play off of what Tracy has said, sometimes it's hard to get people here, but once they're here.
That's true.
it's really eye-opening to see what people have to say about Lynchburg and the surrounding area. From a confidence standpoint, speaking from a health perspective, we're as confident as we've ever been, and we're as excited as we've ever been. We're as close to the community in all parts of it. We're as close as we've ever been. And that's not just being close, but understanding the connectivity of all parts of our sectors, whether it's the business alliance helping be a connector, whether it's our nonprofits really filling the gaps and trying to break generational poverty. We're as excited as we've ever been, because we're not just here to operate on people and image them. We're here to make sure that they have the healthiest life that they can. And our realization is that that's just not about healthcare. That's having a healthy community.
I mean, I think we've all said the word resilient, I think, in one form or another today. And I think the business community certainly would say that they've been resilient. Innovation comes to mind in terms of our business community, and then being solutions oriented. You know, it's not the societal issues we've all talked about today are not just societal issues. They're business issues, because those businesses have chosen to make this region home. And so they're rolling up their sleeves to work on these collectively through collective impact. And how are we going to come together and create solutions for the good of our community, for the good of our employers and our employees? And I think, injecting hope and staying resilient are what's going to get us through.
Well, this is great. And I really appreciate you guys taking what's already been an hour and a half, with us here. I just tag on to something Stephanie said, which is that it's hard to imagine that we felt there was a lot of uncertainty 2 years ago. We did, but compare that to where we are today. Because look at all that's changed, right? Health and health outcomes, schools and whether they're open or not, transit, whether it's available or not, government benefits and the level, the size, the scale, consumer demand, and whether it's for, you know, no more services, but a lot more goods, supply chains, we talked about, wages, labor availability, costs, prices. It's actually an incredible list. And when things change like that, those of us who you've entrusted to try to help steward the economy really get benefit out of being here with you and understand what's actually happening. So thank you for taking the time with us. And really appreciate
all of your thank you for help. Hosting it in Lynchburg.
Thanks well, we didn't make you come to us. We actually come to you. Thank you. So thanks, everybody. Great to be with you.